pray. Creator God, we marvel in awe of the expansiveness of your creation. Your margins of diversity are boundless, and for that, we thank you. Each of our beloved LGBTQIA plus siblings are beautifully and wonderfully made, all in your image. Teach us to love people just as they are and embrace their identity fully as you have embraced us. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Weaver of justice, let us be your hands and feet. May we follow the Spirit's lead and work for justice and equity for our LGBTQIA plus siblings. We are committed to your ministry of reconciliation. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Amen. Please join me in the call to worship. The courage to have pride. It often seemed we forever came out of closets, only to enter the shadows and flee underground. That harsh reality required courage, the courage to be, the courage to be the fabulous creators of creatures God created. Love, same love, can come in sapphic form. Two women pledging love and devotion to each other. Giving love, one man to another, and longtime companionship. Like all same love, that same love should be celebrated. By any name, loving both men and women is still real love, whether labeled taboo by society or marginalized by a fellow minority. Transformation at times requires triumphing over trials, which for some are triggered by others' judgment of their need for change. We're all gifts of God. What package we come in shouldn't matter. Celebrating LGBTQIA pride isn't about wallowing in boastful pride. It's about reminding ourselves that we are worthy, even if some people disagree. Life for LGBTQIA people requires a certain kind of strength and resolve. Courage, if you will. The courage to have pride in ourselves. Amen. Ashe.
I'm just going to go ahead and start sharing again. Give me just one second.
Psalm 139, verses 113 to 14. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know that full well.
It is revolutionary for any trans person to choose to be seen and visible in a world that tells us we should not exist.
Please pray with me. May the words that I share bless. Amen. Threads weave together, make fabric. Pieces of fabric bound together make comforters, quilts, and tapestries. We, the children of the rainbow, are connected by threads of many colors and shades. The Creator took spools of thread to weave uniquely made pieces of fabric that she fashioned into a fabulous tapestry called life. Lyrics from singer Carole King's 1971 hit, Tapestry, paint a vivid image. Life has been a tapestry of rich and royal hue, an everlasting vision of the ever-changing view, a wondrous woven magic in bits of gold, blue and gold, a tapestry to feel and see, impossible to hold. Life for LGBTQIA plus people should be a tapestry of rich and royal hue. Some of us, after all, strut through life as kings and queens and everything in between. We, the fierce and fabulous, face a different reality. Society forces us to hide our fabulosity under a bushel. But you can't hide fabulousness any more than you can put a baby in a corner. There was no hiding mine. Twirling around in grandma's faux fur coat, dressing Barbie dolls, and designing clothes were a few ways I spent my childhood. Grandma didn't bat an eye. She didn't question how God made me, so far as I knew. I was free to be me, a fabulous piece of the Creator's tapestry. Sewing kits and quilting frames were integral parts of my childhood. In fact, a quilting frame usually sat over the dining room table, so we added TV trays. Grandma was usually hunched over that frame, creating wondrous sewn magic. Except when at Grandma's house, my childhood wasn't necessarily wondrously magical. Grandma protected me from racist family members and an abusive parent with an addiction. Unlike countless LGBTQIA youth, I was kicked out of my parents' house rather than for being gay, but for reporting abuse. With that said, I'm sure we both vividly recall those traumatic moments. I took my secret with me to Grandma's house. I was gay. I had to stay closeted to keep from losing her, so I thought. That just couldn't happen. But my church outed me at 27, forcing me to come out to her twice. Why did I come out to her twice? During my second coming out, I confronted a truth I couldn't handle. Grandma had Alzheimer's. She was confused the first time and then asked that age-old question. What did I do? She and millions of LGBTQ people's loved ones did nothing. We were born this way. Spending Mother's Day with my ex and I convinced her that was true and that I was happy. Grandma never forgot she loved me even as the Alzheimer's worsened. The Creator blessed me with the greatest cheerleader. Had she had the chance, Grandma would have cheered LGBTQIA siblings, denied that support. I just know it. To those siblings, I say, I'm here. You is smart. You is fabulous. You is loved. Our society says we're unworthy of love, particularly God's love. And I'm going to use an unconventional theological term. I say bullshit. But the Bible says. But the Bible says what? I'll tell you what. It shares two creation stories, one where Adam is given animals for companionship and sustenance, and another where we're introduced to Eve. It's interesting how a creation story is cherry-picked to push an agenda, and not a gay agenda. And while God and Jesus are quite specific about a lot of sins, they say nothing about being LGBTQIA. The Bible tells us David loved Jonathan more than a woman. Yet David isn't punished for that relationship. Jesus healed the centurion's lover without telling them to go and sin no more. And the only abomination occurring in a tried and true clobber passage was engaging in sexual activity inside the temple as a ritual to appease an idol. So homophobes are simply putting words in God and Jesus' mouth. As much as homophobic so-called faith leaders claim the Creator and Jesus hate the fabulous pieces of tapestry that are LGBTQIA people, let's be clear. Neither the Creator nor Jesus said anything about being LGBTQIA. While people have read what they wanted between the lines to justify biphobia, homophobia, queerphobia, transphobia, the Creator and Jesus specifically declared what were sins. Being LGBTQIA wasn't among them. That knowledge doesn't hug homeless LGBTQI youth at night or give them a place to lie their heads. The night ministry does, though. I interned with the youth outreach team, expecting to help them more than they helped me. The complete opposite happened. They taught me about being real and being brave. They taught me you can survive, even if it's hard, without biological families. They taught me that creating chosen families is empowering. Since Grandma left, creating a chosen family has been the only option. Interestingly, like LGBTQIA people, once Jesus left his family, he created a chosen one. Like Jesus, some people treat us like outcasts and dangers to society. Jesus was essentially a person of color who died in police custody. Fear drove throngs of people to demand he be put to death, just like fear is used to justify murdering Black trans women. Fear justifies nothing, even if ignorance fuels the fear. A uniquely made piece of the tapestry shouldn't fuel fear that festers into hate of anyone. We are all woven together with the Creator's thread. Patriarchy and white supremacy have left the tapestry tattered, but not ripped in two. Theologian Paul Tillich wrote a book all about the courage to be. LGBTQIA plus people and people of color, particularly Black people, were born with the courage to be. To be unapologetically Black and unapologetically fabulous. It takes courage to be authentically fabulous in the face of oppression fueled by bad theology and bastardized scriptures. Lesbian womanist theologian Dr. Pamela Lightsey gave us a reminder in the form of her 2015 book, Our Lives Matter. Lightsey shared the wisdom of Bishop Yvette Flunder, Black lesbian founder of the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries. TFAM is a small denomination of LGBTQIA affirming Black churches. Quote, church encourages self-loathing. But our experience with the Creator, rather than how homophobic Black preachers, and let me edit that, homophobic Black and any other color of preacher, have interpreted the text, demonstrates over and over again that the Creator loves us just as we are, in our self-identity, and in our living out that identity. Flunder speaks the truth. God never burdened me with any guilt or shame about being Black and fabulous. I heard her still speaking voice calling me to ministry at age 6. I ignored that call because the contradictory messages coming from the pulpits eventually drowned out the Creator's voice. Thankfully, I heard another call that couldn't be silenced or overpowered. And the Creator reminded me that they've always loved her LGBTQIA plus children, despite claims to the contrary. If knowing you're fabulous is one thing you know for sure, that's the Creator, who's known by many names, assuring you were indeed born this way. You were a fabulous piece of the Creator's tapestry woven from threads of many colors. You are wondrous woven magic that is impossible to hold or define. Let no one tell you otherwise. Amen and Ashe.
Thank you all. Thank you, Jason, for that beautiful word. And I'm grateful just to be here and part of this number. We're gonna do something that just rarely works on Zoom at all, okay? We're gonna make a joyful noise because we're gonna try to do some responsive reading. And every now and then my church has tried it and we keep thinking we're gonna beat it and we never do. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna do the litany and make the noise and come through it. And I think hopefully, we will still be touched and just strengthened by this prayer that we share together. So if you'll join me, please, if we have the text, we can certainly do the litany together then. Let's pray. Supreme artist and master weaver, we come before you woven together in beauty and struggle. And the people say,
open our eyes. The splendor of dawn.
I love this. Give us grace to discover your handiwork and how each of us is made.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to admire your handiwork in every gender expression and identity.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to recognize your handiwork in all of love's patterns and practices.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to embrace your handiwork in every body type and appearance.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to rejoice in your handiwork as it's displayed in the many colors and complexions you bestow on your people.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to draw comfort from your handiwork, which made real in the care and touch of those around us.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to marvel at your handiwork manifested in the wealth of talents and gifts stitched into every life.
Lord, open our eyes.
Oh God, give us grace to stay hopeful in your handiwork as you shape our moments, our meaning, and the world around us.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to remain confident in your handiwork, even though it sometimes feels like everything is unraveling.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to discern your handiwork in the golden threads of those unjustly regarded as the least and the last among us.
Lord, open our eyes.
Give us grace to see your handiwork in places and people we'd rather not look at or hear from or accept.
Lord, open our eyes.
Finally, give us grace and generosity to trust you always, knowing all things really do work together for good when you weave our stories and lives together as you see fit.
Lord, open our eyes.
In the name of all that is holy, pure and lovely.
Amen.
Thank you all for joining us.
1977. Wow.
Walking through life in nature's disguise. Yeah. You laugh at me and you
sorry.
Carefree and gay. Yes, I'm gay. Ain't no fault, it's a fact. I was born so this way. Yeah. Now I won't touch you. Don't you touch me. We're all the way.
So thank you all so much for being here. It was an amazing experience, and I'm glad to have shared it with you, and bless you and bless your journey as you leave here, and